Hello and welcome to another episode of Veterans Virtues. I'm your host, Corporal Tremblay, and tonight my guest is Sergeant Pepper from Dog Company. So, Sergeant Pepper, why don't you answer the question that's on everybody's mind, the reason that we're all here. What first brought you to the 29th?
Oh, that's a question. Probably, I was playing Darkest Hour, because I came from Baker before we did the dog split, and I just saw a bunch of guys with 29th tags just kind of chilling out in a server, and I was like, that seems interesting. Let's go do that. And, well, the rest is history, unfortunately.
Or fortunately, depending on the which way you decide to spin it.
Unfortunately, yeah. But no, it was mostly I just saw a bunch of guys, and they were, like, just wrecking the enemy team. And I was like, hey, you know, I've always wanted to do some type of realism unit, and there's never been a good one. I mean, I've been a part of a few. And they always either seem to have really power-tripping people at the top, or they dissolve within a few months.
Would you say it was a fairly smooth process coming from kind of seeing tags in pubs, checking it out on the website, and kind of dropping in an application, even way back then?
Way back, it was fairly easy. I mean, I don't remember much in terms of details, but I mean, it was, you know, I always remember I went to the website, entered in all the information. It was like, I can choose a name. Let's choose Pepper, because that would be the ultimate hilarious insanity, or whatever the word is I'm looking for.
Well, I mean, and an excellent reference now that you've reached the rank of sergeant.
Yeah, I mean, I always thought the joke would be, it would be super funny if I made it to sergeant at some point and I had the name Pepper, and I somehow stuck it out, and someone thought it'd be nice to promote me to sergeant, and so the joke was complete.
Of course. Now, here's a question that I haven't kind of broken out for quite a few people now, but I want to try it out on you here. I want to see what your thoughts are on this subject. What would you say your kind of how your impressions of the 29th shifted from that first, you know, week of BCT to 4 years on and part of Dog Company?
Well, just starting out, I was definitely, I think everyone had this at some point, was they were shy and unsure of, well, it's a new environment, what are we going to do? To now, you know, when you've been around for a good number of years like I have, you just kind of, you either know everyone or you just seem to pretend to know everyone.
We do seem to attract quite the familiar cast of characters, no matter if you're a year in and just a freshly minted PFC, or a veteran of 4 years and a sergeant.
You get the same. It takes a certain person to join a realism unit, and then it takes another certain person to stay within that realism unit. So at the end of it, you're meeting the same people, and likewise, same games, same interests, and it just goes from there.
Well, you know, you didn't just join the 29th. You seem to have thrived in it, in a way of speaking. So what would you say motivated you past that kind of initial just signing up and along for the ride and on towards, say, SLT and moving on up through the ranks?
I think the biggest motivation was the fact that it isn't just a realism group. It's a gaming community on a grand scale. There's over, 300 people, and every one of them plays a different game, different likes, and being able to find those people who you play the same games. I know in Dog Company, I routinely play multiple games a day with different people. May that be Hoy or Crusader Kings. You know, it's trying to find people of similar interests, and that just motivates you to keep going.
The 29th does seem to attract quite a few people of like-minded interests like that, and you know, a lot of veterans who come on the show do say that it's that sense of community that kind of keeps them going and motivates them.
Yeah, it totally is. I mean, if there wasn't a community here, I don't know if I would have stuck around as long. And I mean, the SLT stuff just comes up after a while.
Yeah, so most people have a mentor or a squad lead, or either if they're not pushing themselves towards it, somebody who kind of pulls them in that direction, who kind of sees that potential. Is there anyone like that for you?
There's a lot of people like that. I mean, I've definitely seen privates who've come in, and they're now just starting to get, like, their own platoons. You know, being able to, like, hey, you know, I was the ASL of that guy, and he's now a platoon leader. It's like, wow, you know, it's kind of cool seeing the amount of drive some people have.
Well, speaking of kind of being able to watch these people kind of grow and excel, like you were mentioning, you saw privates that are now platoon leaders. Would you have any tips for anybody who's kind of considering SLT or kind of leaning in that direction?
Be sure that you want to do it. I've seen people and I've talked to people who said, hey, I want to be an SLT. I want to get a squad just for the rank. You know, unfortunately, what we, a lot of, I'm sure as you know, as being as a corporal, a lot of leadership is just, it's a lot more than just a rank. You have to be a good people person, a good people manager. And if you're unable to kind of have a sense of a person, like if you're talking with someone and you're not able to get anything from them, it's a very hard road to go down. So being able to communicate with people on a very good scale is extremely important.
I agree wholeheartedly, and I'd go so far as to say as the 29th is kind of a unique experience in terms of a leadership role, because you don't have that firm rank structure and authority that, say, the real military or an organization would give you. You pretty much have to be their friend, their mentor, their leader, and kind of pull all these different kinds of soft skills together to really excel, and there is quite a bit to it.
There, you have to be a lot of hats, someone once told me. You know, I myself, you know, I have not worn a lot of those hats. It takes a while to learn some of them. You know, I've definitely made my fair of mistakes every now and then. But being able to be not only a friend, a squad leader, an assistant squad leader, and then being able to turn those on and off is extremely important. If you're on all the time staying as a squad leader, your squad's going to kind of suffer. You're not going to be able to have that open dialogue that is needed to allow your squad to thrive.
And by the same token, if you're always too loose and too fun focused and oriented and having that kind of relationship with the guys, you lose what makes the 29th.
Exactly. So being able to level that off to the point where, okay, I can be a little bit more fun today, but tomorrow I need to be a little bit more on a serious note for the platoon drill, is it's a very hard balancing act. And unfortunately, I've seen a lot of people, they go into SLT, they get in the ASL position, and they don't seem to realize that as quick, or they don't gain that from the knowledge that the SLT classes teach them. So I've seen a lot of guys go into SLT and then just kind of fizz out and get burnt out from it, which is a very real thing.
Speaking of burnout, and that is definitely something that anybody who's been here long enough has had to deal with and manage at some point. What would you say some tips for some of our more veteran members or people who are feeling kind of the burn, as you will? Like, what would you say to them to say, hey, you should consider doing blank to alleviate your symptoms and kind of rekindle that 29th fire?
There's no one answer fits everyone. Everyone's got a little bit of a different mindset. But, I mean, there's one thing I can recommend. Find a friend, doesn't matter the rank, somebody you can trust wholeheartedly and just have fun with them, play games, whatever, talk about stuff, you know? And if they're in leadership, that helps as well because they're on the same level of knowledge with you, right? So try and find someone that you can just play games with. Don't talk about leadership, don't talk about 29th, just play games. And that's how I definitely, when I was getting burnt out, I would just play games with a friend of mine and didn't think about a thing. Of course, that's me, and for some other people, that might not work. But always being remember, there wasn't always the 29th. You know, there's certain days. It took me a while to learn this, is, you know, don't have to be thinking about the 29th constantly. You know, you can always do other stuff around then, and if that kind of makes sense.
I definitely understand, and it's definitely something that sounds counterintuitive, but it's kind of funny because this place, this kind of community that we exist in, it pulls us in during the week, even when it's not our drill times. You know, I find myself often thinking, hey, I'll hop on the TeamSpeak and see what, say, you yourself are doing. What would you say some tips for some of our older members or people who are just starting to feel the burn would be to kind of alleviate that?
Well, unfortunately, there's no one size fits all. Everyone has their own limit, their own starting point, but you know, everyone does feel a little burn every now and then when it comes to maybe the 29th or a certain game. Because you know, some of us have been playing games like, say, RS2 or Squad for quite a while now. And you know, doing the same things in and out definitely gets tiring. Being able to find someone that you can relate to and or just talk with outside of the 29th or in the 29th, you know, if there's somebody there, is definitely a very important part. It helps me out. That's how, you know, when I was SL, you know, some weeks I'd go in there and be like, you know, I don't really feel like being an SL this week. But, you know, you power through for the guys, and then at the end of the week you do a good 10-hour gaming session with about six people that you're just not even thinking about the 29th.
I wholeheartedly agree. There's definitely some nights where you just come into TeamSpeak, say on a Saturday when there's no drills, and you sit down with a bunch of the guys, and say you play a huge game of Hoi 4, for example, and you get kind of that esprit de corps back, and you get that kind
exactly.
of boost that you need to kind of go back into a game that you've played a million times and find something new and run a great drill for the guys, whether that be RS2, Squad, or even Arma 3.
Yeah, and I mean, one of my personal things is, I know some people kind of frown upon this, is I didn't pub the game as much as some other people did. If I pubbed a game for multiple hours a week, I would hate that game until the end. Just my personal kind of the way I work.
I definitely think it's important to have, you know, that kind of viewpoint shared, though. A lot of people say that pubbing is very important, and obviously it is,
exactly.
because that's obviously how you found out about the 29th and how we get
yeah.
most of our recruits. But by the same token, if you feel yourself burning out and you can't focus at drills, maybe spending, you know, 10 hours throughout the week pubbing isn't helping your burnout.
Yeah. You know, if most of the time it's either the game or it's something in leadership that's bugging you, you know, you're like, Squad didn't really perform that well that week, and then that just carries on. Being able to say, well, Wednesday night was a good platoon drill, let's go into Thursday night, and let's just restart. You know, I always, Wednesday night was my AAR. Once I put the AAR in, that week was over. Unless there was something super important, I didn't think about that week anymore. I went into the new week and continuously just, that's how I just made it through week after week, because I don't think on the grand scale of, well, next month I need to do so-and-so for my drill. What am I going to do? I think, okay, well, Friday night I'm going to think of my drill plan. Saturday night I'll think about it some more, and then that way I'm just not burning myself out by thinking 6 weeks in advance of what I'm going to be doing for a drill.
And hey, if you're really feeling burnt out but you still want that, like, 29th experience, go guest another company's drills. Go guest
that
a
is
dog
definitely,
drill.
Yeah.
Right? Go
guest
an EVZ drill. You know, it happens all the time. And we have people who are just more than happy to kind of show other companies the ropes and get them kind of going.
Yeah, I mean, there's three other companies of, like, just individual cultures and little communities of tight-knit people. Like, if you're not finding satisfaction in your own company there that particular day, go guest another company. You know, there's Arma. Arma is, they do some crazy stuff up there. I know they do some awesome mods every now and then. Even in Squad, Easy Company, like, you guys do some awesome, like, the amount of drill scenarios that I've guessed a Squad drill and gone, hey, that's actually kind of interesting, let me pull that and take that back to Dog Company and see how that might work out. It's a really good way to get outside viewpoint and just leadership in general, is by just going to out of your community.
It's a great way to have a fresh experience and kind of new outlooks on things, while at the same time still retaining that core 29th experience that, you know, the community, right? And the important part.
Mm-hmm.
Now, moving on a little bit, speaking to about that community, you know, we have a couple of very important pillars that kind of support everything we do here, and that's the cores, the extracurriculars, if you will, outside of just, say, leading a squad or playing the game and being a part of a squad. Now, you're a part of a couple of cores yourself, and anybody who's considering SLT should definitely check these out. What would you say about the importance of the kind of experience you've had in the cores has had on your 29th experience?
I've definitely been in a few. I mean, I think I've been in the big three or four. What is there? There's Lighthouse, Engineer Corps, and I think Finance is the other. I've been a part of all of those. I'm still part of two of them. being able to, if you can have a staff job and you can complete that too, it's a routine thing. If you can complete that with no problems on a week after week or a month after month basis, you should be fine with leadership. I mean, most of leadership is a lot of paperwork, you know, a lot of being able to fill out stuff. And I've lost my tangent there.
Don't worry about it too much. Now,
sorry, the question, yeah.
Moving on, you mentioned you're in the engineering corps presently, correct?
Yeah, I've been part of the engineer corps since I joined the 29th, I think. I was a level tech back in DH, and that's how I kind of got my start there. And then slowly shifted on into Rising Storm 2, when that kind of their editor was released and not as broken, I guess, as you can say, as many mappers will know, is mapping is a very time-consuming process that likes to throw a lot of wrenches in the works.
I agree wholeheartedly. I only have the faintest, you know, kind of scratching the surface knowledge of it, and from what little I know is that, guys, we take a lot of the mods that kind of create these 29th experiences and make them possible and optimize them for granted. Like, the engineer guys put a lot of work into making, say, our BCT maps and the modifiers and mutators that make our realism scenarios possible in these games.
Yeah, without the volunteer work and just, you know, because a lot of these guys who make the mutators, we're all volunteers. We're not being paid to do this. We're doing this to benefit the community, so we can have a more enjoyable experience ourselves. So, you know, being able to say, hey, you know, like, so-and-so just updated the mutator for us and it wasn't working before. That's awesome. Now we can do this. Maybe we should just say thank you. Because I definitely know sometimes the behind-the-scenes work definitely does go unnoticed. And a lot of people do feel like, hey, you know, put a lot of that work in and didn't really get a lot of knowledge or like acknowledgement of it.
Remember, guys, thank your local engineer, and if you have a suggestion, please go up the COC. They don't need a million PMs.
Yeah, that is probably, yeah, go up your COC and then we'll get it. Don't you know, or there's already placed some stuff in place for you to go.
For sure. And anyone who's kind of considering the engineer corps in our audience, what would your kind of tips or advice kind of be to them, since you're a veteran of the office?
My level of engineer corps, like, I'm a senior level tech, and unfortunately I don't do a lot of mapping as much as I like to, but, you know, being able to be personable and being able to get along with people is extremely important, because that's the only way you're going to learn. You can learn from playing and watching videos and just using editors and whatnot or coding, but being able to, you know, if you need to ask someone a question, just being able to have that kind of that level is extremely important, you know, because in a lot of offices, a lot of people, you know, like, I might ask a question to the chief and be like, hey, you know, like, is this okay? But I can't really do that if I don't have that relationship, you know, so being able to cultivate relationships is extremely important.
I agree wholeheartedly. I imagine that there's quite a bit of learning that goes on while you kind of work your way through engineering.
Yeah, I mean, not everyone's going to be an expert day one, so being able to talk with people and, you know, because sometimes you need to kind of go outside that COC, and I'm not saying you should every day, but if you need to ask a quick question and it's something related, you know, you should be able to at least try and do that. I mean, for my sake, you know, I definitely, a few times I've asked a question, like, hey, you know, can I do this? And they're like, yeah, sure. And I was like, cool.
Yeah, and I mean, especially when you're transitioning games, engines, and the like, communicating within the team and outside the team is probably pretty important.
Exactly, and that translates to leadership as well. If you need to, like, try something out, having a really good relationship with all levels of your leadership is extremely important. All the way down from that ASL to the company commander. If you don't have, you know, just a basic relationship, you know, where you can talk, ask them. Being able, I find, if you can at least ask them a question, you know, if it's, unless you're directly going to there, you should always follow your COC, of course. But if you have to ask a question, they're in the channel, you're like, hey, we're just playing a game, I had a question on this. Being able to have that relationship, I say, is definitely a really awesome thing to have.
And, I mean, let's face facts here. Communication is pretty much all we do here. Doesn't matter exactly. The game. Doesn't matter what level you are. From the lowest private to, you know, Lieutenant Colonel himself. Communication is what makes this whole machine work.
Yeah, without it, we're no better than your average clan or whatever, right? We're no better, you know. It's the only reason is our communication and our devotion to what we do allows us to keep going unhindered.
And it's probably what's mostly responsible for our impressive streak when it comes to scrims.
Yeah. I think we're 14, 15, and one draw, I think, and one loss, I believe. It's been a while since I looked at it, but it's definitely impressive.
Yes, to say the least. And you've been a part of your own fair amount of scrims as well over the years, have you not?
I've been a part of one, almost a part of another. Fortunately, back in the Baker days, there was a scrim going on, but I joined about a week or two too late to kind of get involved there. But I was part of the prep. The main scrim I was a part of with Dog Company was against the, I believe they called themselves the Twitch clan or the DMC clan. It's an eye-opening experience for anyone who hasn't, you know, appreciated what a scrim is and how far out it can be. That's kind of one of our biggest recruiting points is, hey, we do scrimming, when in fact, you know, a scrim is probably once a year.
I mean, it's kind of funny. Like, the importance of scrims is actually a big deal here, right? We take pride in our preparation, and we take them seriously, mm-hmm. and it's part of our kind of 29th mythos, if you will, that we do so well in them consistently. What would you say the importance of scrims was to you throughout your 29th career, considering we are such a big unit, and it almost seems that now our own intra-unit kind of competitions are starting to take such a big place?
I mean, importance to me-wise, I mean, I just always thought I was contributing something, you know, may it be back in my own scrim when we were doing stuff. I think I took it upon myself with another member to just figure out the ranges for you know, our thumper rounds, figure out where do we need to shoot in order to accurately hit targets in the cap, because they were target locked. It allows you to appreciate the game a little bit more. It allows you to appreciate the people around you, because you learn not only, hey, that guy's actually really good at an MG, maybe we should post him here to get the full effectiveness. You really learn what everyone is good at and what people aren't good at, you know, and then that's like, hey, you know, Private Smith over there actually isn't so good with his grenades, but, you know, maybe we can help him improve that so the guys that are defending the objective can get better. It's really just it's a big ecosystem of, you know, as I get better, my attacks get better, and then the defenders, as they defend better, my attacks get better. It's just a big ecosystem, really, as I know.
The 29th ecosystem breeds the best gamers around, would you say?
The rumor of the higher up you go, the worse you get at the game, is fairly true. the ecosystem of just getting better at the game is, you know, the better you get, the better the people around you are going to get, and as you share that knowledge with them. And that's what makes scrims really cool.
I'd argue that the higher up you go, the worse you get at the game, because the more time you spend making sure everyone else is good at the game.
Pretty much, yeah. That is the exact quote I was looking for.
All right. And what would you say to, say, some of our longer-standing members? What would you give as words of encouragement to just keep improving, even if they think that they've gone as far as they can go with, say, either their AIT or their leadership role?
There's always room for improvement. You're never done learning, as I say. Every day is a learning day, as I, you know, as I try and take it, you know. Even if I'm learning one thing, I'm happy. So being able to look at it in that point where you're, well, as a leader, I've been an SL for 5 years now. There's no real movement. What's something I can do just today that can help me be better tomorrow? Being able to do that is, I find, allowed me to keep going.
All right. And would you say that it's kind of that act of continuous kind of mindfulness towards improvement is part of what kind of creates, I don't know, the feedback loop that the 29th gives you, where there's always a new challenge and you're always working to overcome it, and that's kind of what keeps guys here so long, as besides the community.
Yeah. I know as an SL, there wasn't a month where I at least had one type of issue arise that I had to deal with, and that always kept me on my toes. May it be a PFC who finds that they're burning out on the game, or may it be a group of them who are just not really doing what they're supposed to be doing, and I have to throw the whole squad upside down and try and figure out what's going on. Just like random examples of stuff, right? So sure. Always learning from those is a great thing.
Now we're coming a bit to the close of this episode, so I want to take some time and ask you if over your 4 years you have any particular memories of something that's happened in a drill or just on TeamSpeak that you would like to share.
I have quite a few of those, unfortunately. As I've been told, I have a very foolish type of gameplay. I know Sergeant Deb, he always used to record videos for Dog Company, and there's quite a few videos of me out there saying some pretty interesting stuff, whether it be I'm Canadian, Pathfinding's in my blood, or trying to prone on a cliff and falling off said cliff.
Just remember, everybody, no matter what you do, no matter what you say, no matter how alone you think you are,
there's a record of it.
Yep.
So always keep that mindful.
For good and for bad. But mostly for laughs.
Yeah, I mean, if you can't laugh at it, you're not doing anything with it. If you can at least laugh at it, you learn something.
All right. Thank you so much for your time and for doing this interview, Sergeant Pepper.
No problem.
And that brings this latest episode of Veterans Virtues to a close. We'll see you next time with another exciting interview with another long-standing 29th member.